creation, and blessed is the communion into which you gather us. You come to us in everything you have created, in seas and stars and river and rock. But today we celebrate the gift of yourself giving to us in a fragile child, gurgling, crying, laid in a manger, share of our flesh and blood. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Send your Holy Spirit among us that we might follow the star of your hope, reflect the bright beams of your grace and truth, and offer our gifts wherever we find your Son. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Shine your light on us like the blazing sun, withering all that is trivial and false, forcing our roots deeper into your mercy and driving us to seek rest and replenishment in the cool oceans of Christ's love. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Oh, God, come again into this world how we need your inbreaking to dispel the darkness, to bring your grace and your peace and your hope and your love and your joy into this world. Oh God, we come before you on this day and we thank you for all the blessings you've given to us. But we pray for the needs of others, oh God, those whose hearts are broken today out of tragedies in their families this holiday season. We pray for your comfort and peace to be with them, to bring your word of hope and encouragement. Oh God, we come before you as we seek to honor you in praise and worship, that we might glorify Christ above all, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Oh God, we come to adore you, your Son, Jesus the Christ, our Lord and Savior. And now let us pray together the prayer our Lord has taught us to pray in saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, the days are coming close, aren't they? So how are we doing? How's the shopping coming? Anybody not got it done yet? We'll pray for you. Now, guys, I want to give you a word of hint to the guys here. There are some things that are just not on the list. Don't buy her tools that you need, okay? And you know, don't buy her a membership to the gym class. That's not good. Don't buy her candy. And if you're going to buy her clothes, you better know the right size. I made all of these mistakes before, so I know. And so I want to encourage you guys. Well, today our scripture reading is that Christmas story that I wanted, and it never grows too old to hear. We always need to hear the story a time and time again to remind us of God's breaking into our universe. So hear this story of our Lord. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went with her and said, Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. How will this be? Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin. The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, blessed is the child you bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? And as soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones. He has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." And when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has been happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. And when they seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. And may the Lord bless the hearing of his word. One of the two great stories in the New Gospel, in the New Testament, We have the story of Easter, the resurrection story, and we have this wonderful story of God coming into the world. The Christian faith cannot be, these stories cannot be overshadowed by any other story in the history of humanity. There's been great novels written. There's been great stories told. But no one story can overshadow the stories of God. This Christ child comes to us with a purpose, with meaning, and with the answer to our deepest questions, our deepest struggles. So what does a Savior child have to offer us in our world today? Well, take a look around you in our world. Listen to the world news. Read the headlines of any newspaper or magazine, and there you have it. Something needs to change. Something needs a new focus in our world rather than this thing we call evil that surfaces in so many places and in so many ways. So this Christ child comes to offer us a remedy for some of what we see in our lives. You see, the world we live in is broken. Listen, the world we need live in is broken and off course and needs a lot of correcting it to get it back on course for there even to be a future civilization. I don't know what it's going to take other than one thing, and that is for God's abiding presence to come again. The world we live in is broken and off course. So what does this infant child bring to us in this world of ours? Let me suggest four or five things. First of all, this Jesus is a Savior who identifies with our broken and hurt in this world. There's a lot of that in our world, isn't there? Isaiah described this one to come as a suffering servant who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed, for he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. Isaiah described him as a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. As a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, and with his stripes we are healed. Come and behold him, for he knows our brokenness and hurt. Come and behold him who seeks to come into your heart, into your life. Come and behold this child who comes to bring peace to the world. This child who comes to bring hope and joy, and this child who comes to bring healing to you and to me. Each of us are broken in some way, and we struggle with that brokenness at times in our lives, and we have to simply call upon the Lord. The Savior who identifies with our brokenness and hurt. But not only does he come to identify with us and to walk with us and to encourage us in our struggles, he comes to rescue us. To rescue us. Apostle Paul once said of Christ, he has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and transferred us to his kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He comes to rescue us. Oh, we need rescuing, don't we? The mess we make sometimes in our lives, the mess we make in the lives of others, oh, how we need this Savior to come and rescue us and pull us out of that darkness, that dominion of darkness, and transfer us to his kingdom of love and light. Oh, I believe in that kingdom. I believe in that kingdom of love and light for all humanity. It's God coming into the world to bring hope to a broken world to bring hope to a world out of touch. Oh, how he comes to rescue us, each of us. He is our hope in our times of need. You see, our salvation is wrapped up in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. Your salvation, my salvation, wrapped up in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And do we know this child as our Savior? That's the question. Is he our Savior? That by his grace we are redeemed and made whole. He comes to rescue you and me. Our Savior, Jesus, the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. He comes with a purpose. He comes with meaning. Jesus is a Savior who thirdly reveals the heavenly light. Jesus was the image of the invisible God, Paul said, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things were created in heaven and earth, visible and invisible. You see, Jesus is the Savior who comes to bring the light that we need in this world. And he wants that light to be in you. He wants his light to shine through you to the world, that others can see the light shining through your life. I once wrote many years ago I think it was like our 10th high school reunion. We all had to send in words of wisdom. And I remember writing, "There is no darkness so deep that the light of Christ cannot penetrate it." No darkness that he comes to penetrate the darkest corners of the world to bring his light. To come bring light to a darkened world. God cast the stars in the sky, didn't he? Now, sometimes in this city, it's hard to see those stars with all the other lights. But out in the country, you could see the stars shining brightly. And when we look up and see those stars, they remind us that God is still on the throne, that God is still shining down, revealing his light to us, even in the darkness of the world. The heavenly light comes wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. Come and behold him. Come and behold him. When we come to the light of the world, all things are exposed. Jesus wants to bring all of the darkness to the light to be exposed so that we can find our way in this world and out of the darkness. His light brings exposure to the darkness. Fourthly, Jesus is a Savior who rules. He's the only one on the throne of heaven. Did you know that? He's the only one on the throne of heaven. Paul said he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He's the one that's holding this world together. Can you imagine that? Our Christ standing between heaven and earth, and he's trying to hold on to this planet called earth. He's trying to hold on that the world can come to him. He's the one who wants to reign in our hearts and in the world. And sometimes that's a struggle for us, isn't it? Because when the world beats us down, or when the world throws curveballs at us, and the world kind of messes with us, we become angry. We become disenfranchised. We become apart. No, how good God wants to hold us together. He wants to reign in our hearts and in the world. Oh, if we could just hold on to the spirit of Christmas. Have you noticed over the last few weeks some subtle changes in people? A little more kindness, a little more patient, a little more tender. Now, the day after Christmas, they'll be back to blowing horns and shaking fists. And, you know, it's a short season, folks. You got to enjoy it while you got it. You know, it's a shame it can't be longer. Don't shorten your season. And you are responsible for that. Don't shorten your season this Christmas. Live it out. Enjoy the moment. And maybe, just maybe, it might become a part of who you are. Now, some of us, it may be tough. Some of us have a long way to go. I look in the mirror and I shake my head. I say, well, yeah. God wants to hold on to us and not let us go. He's the one on the throne. Jesus, this Savior, wrapped in swaddling clothes. Come and behold him. And finally, Jesus is a Savior who reconciles. He reconciles all things. Paul said, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, and making peace by the blood of his cross. In him all the fullness of God was pleased. This babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, found lying in a manger. God used this infant child to reconcile all things to him. Can you imagine? It's okay, Bernard. It's okay. You don't have to leave me, Bernard. Come on over here, Bernard. I think you and I need to talk a little more. Come on, big guy. You know, this is what it's about. And it's hard for us to comprehend that God, in his creativity, could send us a child. You see, there were those who thought that God was going to send an army of men and to fight. But no, God sent us a little fellow that was wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And God can do wonderful things in our lives. And this little fella can do wonderful things in this world. It's yet to be revealed what that will be. But I know what it will be good, won't it? I know. They're a little scary sometimes. They're a little scary back there sometimes. It's okay. But you and I are tight. We got this, right? Oh, it's okay. It's all right. Oh, my goodness. I've lost my touch. It's okay. It's all right. Oh, you go. Go back to Dad. There you go. There we go. Good boy. God does these things the total opposite of what we think. The total opposite of our thinking. Sending an infant wrapped up in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. God, what are you talking about? How can that be? But God did it. It invites you to come. Come and behold him. He wants to reconcile our lives with him. He wants you this Christmas season to know the one, the reconciliator of all, this Christ. He wants to redeem the lost in our world. Those who have no hope or peace or joy or love, come and behold him. The Savior who identifies with our broken hurt, the Savior who comes to rescue us, the Savior who reveals the heavenly light, the Savior who rules, the Savior who reconciles. He reconciles all things. Come and behold him. Let us pray. Almighty God, your word is ever so powerful. Thank you for this wonderful Christmas season. Thank you for Bernard for being such a sweet fella to illustrate to us the power of your love come down from heaven. In Christ's name we pray, and all God's people said, amen.